Hey pessoal, como vocês estão? Today we're going to try our first video completely in English. Why? Well, a few reasons for that. First one, I have been living here in USA for the last, I would say, almost 6 years. Yes, most of my friends are from Brazil. People that watch my channel and friends, they are from Brazil and they speak Portuguese. But many of them have been telling me, hey Andrew, why don't you, you know, make the videos in English? I want to practice. And also because I'm making new friends here in USA. And they want to know what I think about cars. They want to discuss with me. And for them, Portuguese is kind of a challenge. Actually, Portuguese is a challenge for me. Still, let's talk about the Toyota CHR. Almost forget about the name of the car. And I can start the video saying that it looks cool. You probably already heard me saying that I don't like Japanese design. I don't like Asian Japanese cars, Korean and all that kind of school where we have those crazy design that they look more like insects or other forms. I still prefer the European. The European design is more precise, it's more sober, that's the word. But we are testing this one, and I must confess that the design is not completely horrible. It is okay, it's not bad. This car has kind of a interesting option for the way the doors will open, right? Instead of having the regular handle where you can just pull it, opens the door in the middle of the door, in kind of the waistline of the car, it is right here in the column. There is few cars that do that, Fiat Coupe or Fiat Coupe, right? The Veloster, the Hyundai Veloster, which actually is kind of a competitor of this CHR, okay? So I just finished everything good I have to say about this Toyota. Why? Because the car does not deliver anything. It does not deliver what they tried to do with this car. Hiroyuki Koba, and I'm sorry, I'm probably killing this pronunciation. I don't know, it's Japanese, so. But that is the guy that is on top of this car, the project itself. And he, since 2013, when this concept was created, and the concept car was awesome. It looked awesome, really cool. That is the guy that is leading this project. And he was always saying that it's a driver's car. That is a car that will bring the dynamics and the behavior that a driver would like to have in a car. And I can tell you, it doesn't. It doesn't. First of all, this miserable 2.0 liters, four cylinders, naturally aspirated, which is this in this case is terrible, does not deliver a thing. Few things that bother me. So for instance, in this entry model, where the trim is really low, it's the base model, for you to change from Eco mode or Eco mode to Sport mode, it is a challenge. You need to go through all sorts of buttons and menus inside this dashboard that actually looks from the 90s, even if the car was kind of created in 2013 and released in 2016, it still looks like a 90s car trying to be modern, right? Yeah, they have these, but and even the Sonata and other cars like sedans, they have this kind of console. So we have a 2.0 engine, four cylinders, delivering 144 horsepower with a horrible CVT transmission that is too long. Why I'm saying too long? Because you're gonna probably say, hey Andrew, but it's CVT, so there are no gears. Yes, but this CVT tries to mimic a regular transmission with gears and ratios with a programmable kind of shifting. So it knows there is a cone basically in the CVT, and that kind of belt will dance like simulating the gears and the ratios. This one is programmable, so it has specific positions in that cone that will give you the sensation that you are changing gears, but you are not. And it delivers the small amount of power that this engine can provide in a really terrible way. It shows like 8,000 revolutions per minute. You can get up to like below 7, 6 something, and it takes forever for you to get some revs. It is just not good. The car feels weak. It drives like a... Oh, by the way, the name comes from compact high rider, which means that the car is high. It's kind of subcompact mixed with a crossover with a little bit of coupe. It is just a damn hatchback, but Toyota knows that Americans don't like hatchbacks. So they try to invent new names to say that you have a car that is not a sedan, it's not a coupe, so it's basically a hatchback. You have no trunk. You have no trunk space. It is completely... It's not a feasible, practical car. That's the problem. Inside, you are sitting too high inside a car to have any kind of driver's experience. The seats in the back are too tight for any reasonable average tall person. I'm 5'11 or 1 meter and 80 centimeters, and I don't feel comfortable in the back. The ceiling is, the roof is really low in the back here. I have not much space either. So, oh, one more thing. When you are driving and you want that kind of driving experience, you need the steering wheel to basically give you feedback for you to feel what's going on the road, right? This car, it gives you some weight. I can't complain about that. I cannot. But the problem is this. Doesn't matter how much you move the steering wheel, you see, you don't have the reaction of the car. The car stays like steady and going forward, which means that the ratio between the steering wheel, the gears, and the wheels are too wide, too open. So basically, you don't have that kind of feeling that you are really turning the wheels. That is, for me, like a deal breaker if you are talking about any kind of dynamic behavior, right? So you have bad transmission. You have bad suspension because it is hard. It's really hard. And I'm not saying that it's steady and firm. I'm saying that it's harsh. So when you go really, really fast in a corner and there is any kind of imperfection in the pavement, you're gonna lose the car because it bumps, it bounces against the road, and it starts losing the contact between the tires and the concrete. So it's really bad. It's really bad. It's not good. So, unfortunately, the first video with the first test drive in English will be talking really bad about a car. And Toyota, that is not really the best manufacturer for sport cars. They failed even with a new Supra. That is actually a BMW and a bad BMW, and it looks weird to say at least. So, oh, one more thing. The fuel efficiency that supposedly now with Japanese cars is, oh my god, they're super fuel efficient. No, this one is not. If you try to really go fast and drive a little bit more aggressive, you're gonna get, man, like 18 mpg, right? In metric system, you're gonna get 7 to 8 kilometers per liter, which is horrible. You can get even less if you like really hit the gas pedal and the throttle. So the brakes, not efficient. I noticed that after some time using the brakes a little bit more in an intensive way, they start to hit up too much and you lose efficiency. So yes, guys, it looks okay. It doesn't look that bad for a Asian kind of design, but it's far away from a nice car. From $21,000 to $26,000, it depends on the trim, right? The optionals that you have in the car. It's not worth it. I'm sorry for that, but it's not. I do not recommend this car at all. If you really want to have like a kind of a cheap car that looks cool, even the Civic would be a better option, which I think is horrible, but it's a better car. The Honda Civic. It's compact and it's fuel efficient, and the engine is better, the transmission is better, brakes are better. It doesn't look that cool, but this car is tiny inside, so not cool, not approved. I don't like it. And well, I hope you have enjoyed the first video in English. There will be probably mistakes. I'm not native, man. So I'm not a native speaker, but I think it will help my American friends to understand a little bit what I think about the cars, and will help my friends in Brazil to practice their English. Okay? So it's weird. I usually finish my videos saying beijo. That means kisses. But here in US, we don't send kisses to people. Yeah, it's a different culture, right? So we say maybe see you later. Mas eu vou deixar aqui para vocês o meu beijo. Valeu, gurizada. Abraço.